Right. Kia ora all. Welcome. Thanks again for coming back to us. Sorry about that delay. So welcome to Touch Compass's international webinar series, number 3 for the year. Before we begin, I'll like to invite John, our general manager, to open up the space with a karakia.
Kia ora tātou, and welcome to today's hui. Nā mai haramai ki te kōrero with Dan Daw and the Artistic Direction Panel. I'll kick us off with a opening karakia, a traditional Māori incantation to open our space. Unihia te pō, te pō whiri marama, tomokia te ao, te ao whatu tangata, tātai ki runga, tātai ki rāro, tātai āhaurau. Haumie, huie, tāi ki e. Roughly and quickly translated for you, from confusion and darkness comes the light of understanding. From our understanding of our world comes unity as people. We are interwoven with what is above, what is below, and what is around us, what ties us together. We are interconnected, and through that, we become allied together, moving forward as one. Kia ora tātou, enjoy the kōrero, the conversation today between the Artistic Direction Panel and Dan Daw. Kia ora.
Kia ora, thank you, JT. So just as by way of introduction and welcome, kia ora. I'm Izzy, the creative producer here at Touch Compass. My pronouns are they, them. I'm a Pākehā person with long brown curly hair, so today it's tied up behind my big headphones, and I'm wearing a blue crew neck sweater with the Touch Compass logo behind me as a background. So just before we start, I've got some housekeeping things to go over. Firstly, I see everyone already does, but it's best to keep your cameras off throughout the conversation and your microphones. You can turn them back on when we get to the Q&A section at the end. We'd love for you to come and join us. But at the moment, it's best just to have our conversators. If you want to see your screen without all the other video feeds, you just want the spotlight ones, you can go up into the corner of your image, or the top of your screen where it says view, or the three dots, and you can click on that and there'll be an option that says hide non-video participants, and that will sync up your screen. If you have any questions throughout the webinar, please feel free to pop them in the chat. You can either do that publicly or you can message me directly, and I'll make sure to share all of your questions at the end of the conversation, if you don't want to jump in yourself, which is fine. And if you're joining us over Facebook, Zan will be checking in for comments and questions there. Today we have two NZSL interpreters, Fran and Philippa. They'll stay highlighted throughout the conversation, and at several points they might interrupt just to have an interpreter swap. So we'll take a moment to pause. After today's webinar, we'll be posting recordings of this both on Facebook and YouTube in the coming days. These will have full captions along with the NZSL that is present here tonight. As we all know, those automatic captioners are really don't like the New Zealand accent or te reo Māori. Now, if throughout the webinar there's anything at all that we can do to make this more accessible or more enjoyable for you, do not hesitate to reach out. If you're on Facebook, reach out to Zan. If you're here on the stream, reach out to me in the chat, and we'll see what we can do to make that work. But I won't take up any more of your time. Today's conversation with Dan Daw, Suzanne, and Lusi, we're really looking forward to it. So I will pass it over to Lusi to introduce herself and let the conversation begin. Thanks so much, everyone. Enjoy.
Kairo or Kowtow. Greetings to you all. I am Lusi Faiva. I use she and her pro. I'm a Samoan and European performer and an independent collaborator with cerebral palsy. I have different verbal abilities to assist me in speaking through the communication app on my iPad. I'm sitting in my power chair in my living room. I got my black hair clipped back and I'm wearing a red long sleeve top and green top on the top over it. I've been working and performing in Aotearoa, New Zealand and over in Australia with Touch Compass for almost 26 years, but I've been involved with the arts industry since I was in my teens. And also I'm on the Artistic Direction Panel with Suzanne Cowan and Rodney Bell over a year now. So welcome, Dan. So excited for hearing about you and your experiences being an artistic person, the loafer.
Kia ora. Thank you, Lusi. My name is Suzanne Cowan. My pronouns are she, her. I am sitting here today in my wheelchair, and I've got medium length brown hair. I have green eyes, pale skin. I'm of European, Irish, Scottish, English heritage. And I am wearing a brown knitted dress with a V-neck, and I have a rectangular shaped window behind me. And I'm very excited to be here today talking with Dan and hearing about his amazing experiences as an independent artist. And so I want to welcome you, Dan, and also just as a little introduction, Dan is a British Australian queer crip disabled artist based in Manchester, the UK. And Dan works collaboratively with a growing network of companies and artists to develop new work in the UK and for international audiences. Dan has his own company, Dan Daw Creative Projects, that exploits his deviating functionality to examine what it means for him and other queer crip disabled bodies to occupy, take up space, and be unapologetic in non-disabled spaces. And Dan is currently working as International Tunsmiss NRW Associate Curator. Dan was previously the Associate Artistic Director at Kanduko Dance Company, and also a Sadler's Wells Summer University artist. He's currently the Associate Director of Mumeration, based in Australia. And Dan continues to work at the forefront of international performance programming and disability-led performance making. And his most recent work, which we're going to be very excited to hear about, is the Dan Daw Show, which is currently touring. So Dan, I just want to welcome you to our kōrero, and if you'd like to introduce yourself, and thank you.
Sure, Suzanne, thank you very much for having me. Dan Daw speaking. So I'm Dan. My pronouns are he, him. I'm a white middle-aged male with a ginger shaved head and a goatee. I've got pierced ears. I'm wearing a high-vis jumper, and I'm sat against a background of various small objects in my bedroom on a shelf behind me. Again, that's set against a white wall, and there's a window and a curtain to my right hand side. It's great to be here. Thanks for having me.
Thanks, Dan. Dan, you very much forged your own path as an independent performance artist, and I was wondering what have been some of the major milestones for you.
So I would say I've had a lot of help along the way in forging that path. Like, I'd love to be able to say I'd done it all myself, but I'm a firm believer of interdependence, particularly from our disability justice points of view. So I have had a lot of help and a lot of people have opened, both disabled and non-disabled, have helped to open doors. So the milestones for me was I started my dancing career with Restless Dance Theatre back in 2002. I joined Restless. And that really opened my eyes to see that being a dancer was possible. I didn't realize it was a thing. I didn't come across can-do Cowan until a few years later. So Restless was really my first experience of going, oh, I'm disabled, I inhabit this body, but I can dance. When I grew up in quite a small outback town, and so my only experience of dance was essentially by able-bodied people, non-disabled people, the ballet, the contemporary dance companies. So I never saw myself represented on stage until Restless came to Wyala, which is the town I was born, to perform a work called Sex Juggling, and that was back in 1998. So it's been quite a trajectory for me. And I would say the next milestone for me was connecting with Gary Stewart and Australian Dance Theatre, and having the experience of dancing with professional dancers was a really, really an eye-opening experience. And I was like, I remember being in rehearsal and going, oh, I'm matching these dancers. And that felt really good to go, oh, okay, I know this space, and I know how to work in this space and be able to be in this space in a kind of not equal, because we weren't equal, but to be able to match them. I think match is a good word there. And then the next milestone was coming over to the UK to dance with Kanduku Dance Company. And I danced with them for a number of years. And that was a really great experience to have the experience of dancing full time for a company, and to dance in very different works as their position as a rep company, and to notice what that did to my body, both for better and for worse. And it was really great to have that chunk of experience and that chunk of time to really embed myself in the UK. And then that moves me on to the establishment of Memoration. That was a really key point for me when I was approached by Sarah Vine Basalo back in 2013, about starting a professional integrated dance company in Sydney. That felt like a really important thing to do, to as a way of bringing my knowledge and what I've learned in the UK back to Australia. And finally, the next milestone for me, establishing Dan Daw Creative Projects and especially making the Dan Daw Show. And in making the Dan Daw Show, I found an incredible company of people, of artists I love working with, and I've decided I'd like to continue working with in some form as we move forward on other projects.
Awesome. So you've moved from working in a established sort of integrated dance company format to forging your own independent career. So how would you tell us a bit about your journey of disability leadership, or how do you kind of, how do you interpret disability leadership? What does that term mean for you?
We'll swap interpreters. Sorry, Dan, we'll just swap interpreters while you're thinking of an answer.
Okay. Disability leadership, what does that mean? I've been on quite a complex journey with disability and leadership. So for me, it's about creating spaces where disabled people and disabled artists can be seen, and creating spaces where non-disabled people move out the way, essentially, because there's a lot of yeah, it's a very good question. So disability leadership means that I'm able to drive an artistic process forward without too much intervention from non-disabled people who don't get it. Because I've found in my past experience that to be very damaging. And because there's this, I'll call it a phenomena, that the moment, there have been moments in my career where I have tried to create disabled only spaces and disabled led spaces, and then non-disabled people approaching me and saying, oh, you're excluding me, and it's this thing of like it's very hard to make work and make spaces that's just about the disabled crip lived experience, because there are always non-disabled people saying, oh, but what about me? I'm missing out, you're excluding me. But when the shoe's on the other foot, they're really not that bothered. So it's really interesting to essentially notice the non-disabled privilege that comes into play there. So I think it's, being a disabled leader is about creating spaces where disabled people can feel empowered in those spaces, and allowing the non-disabled people in who want to help with the freeing of disabled bodies. That's my aim. And if non-disabled people aren't up for that, then they're not welcome in the spaces I create.
Awesome. Mm-hmm.
I just like your quote from your show. After years of hating my body and rejecting my body, With this show, I'm celebrating my body for the first time, he says, and it's liberating in the most spectacular way. Dan Daw, on the Dan Daw Show. My questions are, do you think your performances in the UK have changed the perspective of the audience's expectation of you as the performer? With the Edinburgh Fringe Festival, tell me about your exploration of the festival itself. The challenges are still going on as you bring the focus on the disabled artists in the spotlight.
Actually, presenting the Dan Daw Show at Edinburgh Fringe Festival was a milestone, I guess you could say. As the quote Lisa read highlights, this show has done incredible things in terms of the way I see my body and the way I'm able to celebrate what I call my messy body, and able to own my mess and mess that I identify for myself, and that enjoying it, like delighting that I have a messy body, and I'm really enjoying through performing this work, audiences coming up to me afterwards and going, particularly queer, crip, disabled, neurodiverse audiences, going, wow, you've really made me realize that it's important to take up as much space as I can and to not apologize for who I am. And also noticing that it also resonates with non-disabled women as well, because they're like, wow, okay, I need to take up more space, don't I? I'm like, yeah, you probably do. And it's really heartening to see that the work affects people in such a way and this is why I'm really pleased with the work we've done here, because it's not about going, okay, I need to change this about the world. It's about them going, I need to change how I am in the world.
Yeah. Mm.
And so it's this thing of, oh, I need to change how I am. And then the more audiences who see the work change who they are, then maybe change will start happening. So it's really nice to kind of see that function of the work. But for me, it's really special when it touches people in this way.
So do you think your show is about giving disabled, particularly disabled queer crip people, permission to be who they are and to really relish it?
100%, and it like encouraging, like, you know, encourages to go, oh yeah, we are sexy, we are sexual beings, we do have appetite, we do have desire, and I see this work as kind of re-sexualizing the disabled body, and to really not shy away from that. And for context for everyone on this call, the work is essentially me being dominated on stage by my fellow performer and collaborator Chris Owen, where I'm dominated on my terms in various ways, in an attempt to use his non-disabled body to set my body free. And the guiding question for this piece was going, how could I derive pleasure from using a non-disabled body who uses my disabled body. So speaking strongly to care, to interdependence, and also to power, and unlocking the shame I've felt for so many years around my crippled body and around kink, being kinky, and to finally find a way to celebrate that and transform that into shame, into pride, rather.
Awesome. Well, that's a massive journey. What about, I'm curious about, you know, you're talking about the power relationships, because obviously, you know, you're talking about giving disabled people more space, and yet then in the Dan Daw Show, you've got the power relationship, you've got the non-disabled person who's dominating you, but you know, as in, you know, with King, it's actually, you're really the one who's in control, because you're asking him to do certain things which are going to pleasure you. So it's quite a complex power relationship, isn't it?
It really is. It is quite complex. And it's essentially about going, how can we get what we need? How can we coexist and get what we need from each other, and to find joy and pleasure in that?
Yeah.
And that's what the work examines, going, how can we coexist in a sexy, joyful way?
Yeah. And I'm curious about the kind of responses you've got from audiences, because I imagine for some people, particularly, you know, who aren't familiar with that world, it's going to really mess with their heads.
Well, yeah, we're really, in making the work, it was really important, because we knew that kink was scary for a lot of people, and disability is scary for a lot of people still, for some weird reason. But they just need to get out more, but there we go.
Yeah.
Right? But it was really important that all audiences saw it as something that was beautiful, and saw that kink wasn't actually about violence, and it wasn't about making the other person hurt and feel bad. It was actually the opposite, and that care is deeply embedded into the kink experience, and that care is deeply embedded in the crip experience. And to really draw those parallels between living in the world with a disability and living in the world as a kinkster, and what that was. So we really tried to, with the shape of the work, we really tried to we hold the audience's hand quite tightly to begin with. I introduce the show and explain what's going to happen, and over the course of the show, I slowly let the audience's hand go and loosen my grip, but we're still there if you need. But we set up things like, you're free to go if this isn't for you. We'd love for you to stay, but you're free to go if you need to. And so we do a lot of holding of the audience, and that holding as well comes from having what, having pre-show access, which is something developed by our access support person, Zed Lightheart, He's developed pre-show access, which means for audience members who need it, they can go, they can show up to the venue an hour before the show starts to look through our trigger menu, to have a walk through of the set on stage, to pre-book their seats, to look at various photos of the show, just to prepare themselves for what's going to happen, if they need to know what's happening, because the work is quite sexual, it really goes there, so it's important that people who need to know what to expect have that there. So that's an important thing for us, is the work is about care, so then our relationship to our audiences needs to be founded on care as well, and to make sure that the care we have for each other as a team extends to all of our audiences as well.
Wow, that's amazing.
We'll just swap interpreters, please.
Of course. Excuse me.
Thank you.
There's a global movement in the arts where performing arts companies are working directly with Indigenous or First Nations artists. What have you seen in the UK or worked with yourself that you could talk about?
Sorry, the question again?
There's a global movement in the arts where performing arts companies are working directly with Indigenous or First Nations artists. What have you seen in the UK or worked with yourself that you could talk about?
I don't really have any knowledge to bear in that respect, I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm. All good. I'm going back to the Dan Daw Show. Dan, I was just curious if, as part of your research, you were drawing from any other disability artists, such as Bob Flanagan or Martin O'Brien?
I don't think so. I tried to keep it to my direct relationship of my body and of my cripness and how it relates to the world around me. So of course I see work by other disabled artists, but I don't think I was very conscious in the making of Dan Daw Show that I kind of in a way stayed in my bubble so that I could really concentrate on how I relate to the world and how I connect to the world and help what I want from the world, so that I don't get into the danger of appropriating lived experience that isn't mine. But it was really important with this work that we really went there and didn't shy away from me owning my body, because there were various points in the making of the show where I'm like, I can't do that. There's no way I can do that. And spoiler, I could and I do. But it's about giving myself permission, I think.
And in the process, giving other people permission.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. And people seeing the work and going, oh, okay, I can get that for myself too. And that's been the incredible thing about this work, I think, so far.
I'm also interested in the idea of making the private public. And so, you know, sexuality often being seen as something that happens in the private, and then the idea of making that and putting that on stage and making that very public, and particularly for a disabled person who is already perhaps perceived from the, by the non-disabled world as kind of deviating from the norm. And then so to even take that further by deviating even further from the norm. I'm just curious about your, how you relate to that idea of making the private public. And was that something that you consciously were sort of doing or thinking about?
Absolutely, because I kept the kinky aspect to myself very secret, like no one knew. And so it was a very big step for me to go, oh, okay, how do I inspire myself? Oh, it's through kink and through being dominated. I need to tell this story. I need to talk about how it makes me feel. And I look at, you know, I'd scroll through Instagram of, you know, queer people out in their latex and out in the leather having a really good time and always wishing that I could have the, that I could give myself the permission to do that. And then I'm like, hang on, why aren't I doing that? And so then that's when something twigged for me around that and going, no, I need to create a show where I do that, where I inspire myself and to give myself that inner space where I feel completely safe and completely at home, and it's, and that's theatre. So kind of Dan Daw was a way of creating this world that I imagined for myself when I move into kink spaces and what I want that to be. So yeah, it is a massive, massive thing of private versus public, and it's incredibly powerful and empowering, and also very emotional. Like I cry at the end of every show.
Wow. Or
during every show.
Wow.
Because it's just to do this with Chris and to do this with an audience watching me is incredibly liberating, and it's this bizarre thing of like, wow, I waited my whole like my whole sexual life to do something like this, and I never have. It's like, why did I wait? So it's kind of a little bit, it's pride, it's shame, but also a bit of regret of like, why didn't I do this so earlier? Why didn't I access this bit to myself earlier? And so yeah, it's really powerful to allow an audience into that, because it is quite a vulnerable piece of work in that sense.
Oh, incredibly.
It feels like I'm letting the audience into my bedroom.
Yeah, which is, you know, that's really vulnerable. And I guess you know, you're talking about, you know, why you didn't do it. And I guess it's around keeping ourselves safe. And especially as disabled people, because we already risk being rejected by people because of our disability. And then I guess often there's an underlying fear that if we push it too far, oh, we're going to be completely rejected.
Yeah.
And so I think, that makes it even more vulnerable and more brave. And what I really notice is that, you're really interested in making spaces accessible in a way. So you're creating a new psychological space. You're making that accessible to people, and particularly disabled people. So forgive me my interpretation rant, but I just find it really fascinating. Yeah, it's really fascinating territory.
No, for sure. And I think they're hit the nail on the head there. Really, really astute observations.
And so, you've been making spaces accessible quite literally as well. You've been, I saw something on Facebook about trying to make an accessible theatre for disabled people. Is that correct?
Yeah, so I've been working over the past few years with a company called Studio 360, who are a design company over here in the UK. I approached them during the first lockdown about going, I've been thinking about this for a number of years and thinking about designing and then building a universally accessible arts centre or theatre and working with, but the foundation being community consultation right from the word go. And we became quite interested in going, okay, if care were embedded into architecture in the same way it's embedded into the work I make, what shape would buildings be?
Mm.
What shape would they actually be? So we got really interested in that, and so we thought about going around the UK and having consultations, talking to disabled, black, brown, trans people about their experiences of visiting theatres and what they need, what they would need from the theatre to A, access it, but also be able to feel free in that space and to inhabit their body in a different way. So we then said, okay, well, what if we develop this kind of Disneyland version of a theatre? Like what would that be? So it would be about saying yes to everything. So for example, there might be 50 entrances to the venue. There might be 10 versions of seating in the auditorium. There might be 15 different door handles. And so going through each element to say yes to everything. And then based on that, working with a digital artist to create a digital imaging of that, of those spaces. And then whittling that down to go, okay, well, we can't have 50 entrances if we're going to build it, but we could have 4. And then working with the participants to narrow down what those 4 entrances would be, and then slowly arriving at a venue that could be built one day. It's going to be a very slow project, but I'm okay with that. But the end goal, it's essentially the start of a capital build project.
And is it possible to see a rendition of this space?
And if we can just swap interpreters, sorry.
Sure.
Ready.
Sorry, I just had to do something, but thanks for the request. So this project's been going for, we're in our third year now, but we're still very much in the planning stages. So it will probably be like something that will be bubbling alongside of me for my whole career. It will be years in the making. So not yet, but what's this space?
Sounds very inspiring. Kind of like a crip paradise.
Exactly. And working with our communities to find ways of getting what we need. That's what I'm all about.
Awesome. Lusi, do you have a question? I notice we're getting towards, yep.
Any further plans to come to New Zealand performing?
Not yet. We haven't been invited. but we would love to come if the invitations were there.
We are
due to come out to Australia in February. I'm not able to say what for. But we're due to be coming out to Australia next year.
Yeah.
With the show, but we're not allowed to say where or with who. But again, watch this space. we'd love to come to New Zealand if the invitation were there.
Awesome. And is there anything else you're looking forward to, Dan, at the moment?
Yeah, there is. We've just started a 3-year partnership with a venue in Hamburg called Kampnagel. Looking at how to embed care and access into what they do as an institution, and to develop various programs and curate a festival, and to do a lot of care-centered work with their organization in the next 3 years. So that's really exciting. We're also going to be performing the work. We're touring to Berlin in November with the work. We're touring Manchester with the work. We're taking the work to Hamburg. We're taking the work to Australia, possibly Canada. So lots of exciting things on the horizon, on the boiler.
Oh, fantastic. I think we're getting towards the end of our official time and opening it up for questions. So I'll hand it over to Izzy at this point.
Thanks, Suzanne. Thanks, Lusi. Thanks, Dan. Oh my God, this kōrero is so engaging. Thank you for all the amazing wisdom. We're going to open it up to everyone here. If anyone's got any cues, and hopefully we can A some of those cues. I do have a list of questions that have come in privately over chat and from Facebook. But before I launch into that, was there anyone in the room who had anything for Dan? Okay. So the first question I have, Dan, obviously your work, you have a lot of advocacy in your work, both as a queer person and as a disabled person. Where would you begin in describing your intersectional approach to someone? How do you balance your disabled identity with your queer identity, not just in your works, but in your ongoing advocacy that we see in your, at least in your social media presence and other places?
Great question, thank you. And I was at a disabled world makers lab last week in Hamburg, and we were talking about this, about the older I get, the more I feel that my cripness is wrapped up in my queerness, and that my cripness is part of my queerness, and my queerness is part of my cripness. It's really, really quite interchangeable in the intersectionality is kind of interchangeable in a way. So because it was like, oh, my cripness is there and my queerness is here, but actually I'm finding a way of combining them in a quite an effortless way. I mean, granted, it's taking me a long time to get to this point, but it makes a lot of sense in terms of, and I spoke about this last week in the lab, for me it's about bringing my whole self to work and I love that I've reached a point in my career where I can go to work and come to calls like this and talk about queer disabled people fucking and having conversations about how we fuck, having conversations about how we give ourselves pleasure, how we give other bodies pleasure, what we like, what we don't like, and allowing that in, because it's like we're queer, we're disabled, we're allowed to have these conversations because that's why I'm queer. Like, and allowing that to be present in everything I do, and but also to Clark, if we had this call 2 years ago, 3 years ago, I wouldn't have talked about fucking then. But so something has really shifted to go, actually, why am I pretending I'm not this person when I go into a professional setting or go into a work setting? So really, yeah, the key for me there in answering the question is about bringing my whole self to everything I do and to not fear whether something's okay or not, because if people aren't okay with something, they would say,
awesome.
Thank you, Dan. Another question that we have received, it sounds like the Dan Daw Show has been a long time in creation. What has been the reality of working on a single show for such a long time?
It's been great to be able to sit with something for such a long time, and great to be able to sit with myself for such a long time in such a focused way. I started creating the work before lockdown. When we got thrown into lockdown, it allowed me to be with myself in a different way, because I was staying because I was staying at home, I wasn't up against ableism on a daily basis. So it allowed me to inhabit my body in a new way and to go, oh, okay, now that I don't have people telling me my body's wrong every day, I actually quite like my body. And so it allowed me to create this different framing and to go, okay, because before lockdown, it was going to be work about how others perceive me. But through this process of being in what I call being in my soft shell and being able to like strip the armor away, I was able to be with myself in a different way and to think about how I perceive myself. And then taking that out into the world to go, okay, I see you looking at me in the way you're choosing to look at me, but I'm concentrating on how I'm perceiving my own body at the moment. I don't care how you're perceiving my body. I'm going to focus on how I'm perceiving my body. So taking the power away from the ableist gaze and owning that and making it something that is useful and empowering for me. So that's what spending so much time on the work did, because if we hadn't had lockdown, I wouldn't have had that life-changing experience of what it is to be with myself and to work out how it is I feel about my body, because I never had that chance to be able to really work out how do I feel without everyone else's input. How do I actually feel about my body? And I'm like, okay, I actually fucking love this body. And really going, and that's where the mess crept in, and really enjoying the mess of my body, and just to be able to be in a place where I can celebrate my mess. It's joyful, joyous.
Oh, wonderful. Trish, you've got a question for Dan?
Can we just hold that? I really need to blow my nose. I'm really sorry.
How are you, Suzanne?
Good, thanks, Trish. How are you?
I'm love to do a workshop with you one time.
Sure.
If it helps to know a little with touch compass again.
And have you got a question for Dan?
Dan, do you have, I don't mean to be rude, but do you have cerebral palsy?
I do. I don't usually like to go to what we're all diagnosed with. But yes, I do have cerebral palsy.
But I have cerebral palsy. I am proud of who I am because I believe this map is cerebral palsy map. I believe that cerebral palsy is part of who I am, and I've been at the same of that. So.
Yeah, absolutely. It's part of who I am as well. Yeah, totally. As I said, cripness and disability is very much a part of who I am, but I feel that For me, politically, I don't need to name my diagnosis. That neither here nor there for me.
I believe that they could be normal. Yeah, that's all.
So my internet broke up then.
Okay. We'll swap interpreter, please.
Thanks, Trish. Looks like Dan's internet has just done a bit of a freeze up, so we'll just wait a moment. Welcome back, Dan. All good on your end?
Yeah, all good. Yeah, the server Perfect. Just booted me out.
No worries. That is the reality of the Zoom world we live in.
Exactly.
This last question is, well, actually, we have a couple more questions, but we'll see how we go for time. But this next question, when done right, it seems like dance is such a wonderfully free and accessible space because of the ability to push and expand boundaries and be fully engaged in creation. How can we take these qualities to theatre and other performing arts and make theatre shows more accessible and attractive to disabled artists? How do we make Shakespeare or opera as attractive to disabled artists as a newly devised work?
Yes. Can I have the questions again, please? Sorry.
Absolutely. So, how can we take these qualities to theater and other performing arts and make theater shows more accessible and attractive to disabled artists? For example, how do we make Shakespeare or opera equally as attractive to disabled artists as newly devised works are?
Yeah, for me, it's about allowing the space for that to happen, because I assure you, if ballet companies, if opera companies approached any disabled person and went, okay, we'd like to make our work accessible now, we're ready, you'd be like, okay, let's do it, let's you know it. So for me, it's just about the will of people and essentially white non-disabled people, like having the will to make things accessible, and disabled audiences aren't currently coming to those things and aren't interested in those things because they're not seeing a way to access it. Because they're not the directors of those works aren't making them accessible. So it's about embedding accessing care into opera, into ballet, into theatre, so that more people can access it, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, and that is such a big part of what we're all trying to do with Touch Compass and a lot of other companies across New Zealand right now, is just putting access in at the ground level.
Yeah. And that's the thing, access is quite often an afterthought. And that's what I mean when talking about embedding access. It needs to come at the start, and thinking about how we are embedding access into everything we do as makers. That's our responsibility. Because disabled people pay taxes too, and disabled people also finance the work you're making through your local arts councils. So it's your responsibility to make the work accessible, because disabled people are paying your rent as well.
Well, I think that's an excellent thought for us to end the Q&A on, because I am just aware of time. Lusi, Suzanne, I'll pass it back to you if you have any final words before we close us out for the day.
I just want to thank you, Dan, for sharing with us today your experiences. And it's amazing to hear the journey that you've been on. And I mean, I've been interested in your career for years since you moved to the UK and kind of followed you on and off. And so it's just such a pleasure to have the opportunity to have a more sustained conversation. Yeah. And I really hope that our paths cross in the near future.
Thank you. Thanks, Lisa. Thank you.
Okay. Well, a huge thank you from all of us, Dan, for your amazing wisdom and sharing your journey tonight. And thank you to Lusi and Suzanne for hosting this kōrero. And an especially big thank you for everyone who tuned in. If you are watching this in a few weeks from now, welcome. We hope you enjoyed it. If you're watching us live, thanks for being here. Hopefully see you all again next time, which is October 14th, with Mark Travis Rivera out of the States. And in the meantime, if you ever want to know more about Touch Compass, see what we're up to, you can check us out at touchcompass.org.nz. Or feel free to flick me an email. I'm producer@touchcompass.org.nz. Once again, Dan, Lusi, Suzanne, thank you so much. And we'll close out with a karakia. JT, I'll hand it over to you.
Kia ora tato. I think we can all agree, beautiful and powerful and challenging insights, Dan. Really appreciate what you've brought to today's kōrero or our conversation. I'm very excited to hear of the time and space that you had and were able to give yourself to make work. It's probably one of the key things that we've recognized as an organization that we want to bring. And thankfully our funding bodies that support us recognize that time and space to make work is an important thing. So we're all on that journey, and kudos to you for the way you've approached it and the challenge you've thrown down to both ableist society and to heterosexual, metrosexual society. I have nothing but admiration for you. I'll close this out with a traditional karakia. Māori incantation to finish, and I think this one is appropriate. Kia whakaria te tapu, kia wātea ai te ara, ka tūriki whakatā a ai, kia tūriki whakatā a ai. Haumie, huie, tai kie. Restrictions are cast aside. The path is now clear for us to return to our everyday lives. Richer for this experience, allied together, hearts, mind, and body, in thought, and one. Kia ora.
Kia ora. Thank you, JT. Thank you, everyone. We'll be seeing you again next week, for sure, on October 14th. Have a good night. Ka kite.
Thank you.